Welcome everyone to Mount Calvary Lutheran Church for our time of worship. And this week we have Vacation Bible School at Mount Calvary. You can see around me a lot of the props that we are using to teach the children about Jesus. And what a joy. You would think we had 126 kids sign up for Vacation Bible School this week. And it's been going very, very well. So thank you for your prayers and your support of our Vacation Bible School. Preaching this week is Vicar Darrell, but I'm going to be leading you in our time of worship. So let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for our Vacation Bible School, for our 50 volunteers who spent the week here telling the kids about Jesus, for all the families that brought their kids here to hear the good news. And be with us now as we worship you and continue our sermon series on the book of James. Amen. Stand for our opening of worship. We begin today's Vacation Bible School celebration in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We take a moment of silent confession. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy upon us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear now the good news. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows upon them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord who began this good work in us bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. You are forgiven and you are loved.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Bible reading for this week goes with our reading of the book of James, from James chapter 2, verse 1. My brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing the fine clothes and say, "Here's a good seat for you," but say to the poor man, "You stand over there," or "Sit on the floor by your feet," have you not discriminated amongst yourself and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers, Has not God chosen the poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised to those who love him? Have you insulted the poor? It is not the rich who exploit you. Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in the scriptures, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convinced by the law as lawbreakers. This is the word of the Lord. We now make our profession of faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. What do we believe in as followers of Jesus? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Hello, I'm Vicar Darrell, and we are going to continue with our sermon series on the book of James. Right now, we want to go to a video to start off with, honoring fathers for Father's Day. In this video, you'll see that there are things that a good father would never say. Now, keep in mind, this will also be a reminder for us when we get to chapter 2 about things as followers of Christ we would never do.
Life is always fair.
I really enjoy repeating myself over and over again.
I just love when the kids talk back to me. I don't care if you get a job this summer. I don't care if you get detention.
I can't open this jar.
See if Mom can open it. Just take your time in there, okay?
No means maybe.
Hey, why don't you bring that ball inside and play with it?
Hey, don't put that back where you found it. Just leave it on the floor.
Ew, bacon.
If you put a dent in the car, it's really no big deal.
It's 10 a.m. Go back to bed.
Look, whatever your friends are doing, just do the exact same thing.
I got more than enough sleep last night.
If your friends are okay with it, then I'm okay with it.
Stop signs are just a suggestion.
You don't need a chaperone.
You don't need a seatbelt.
You don't need a savings account. You should buy the jeans with the holes in them.
Hey, we're all gonna go to church, but you can just sleep in, okay?
Can we please just hang out in here for another 10 minutes?
Hey, can we get some more bickering back there?
All right, bills!
Yay, traffic!
Woohoo, taxes!
Yes!
Laundry!
Hey, can you kids come in here and jump on my bed?
Quick, go tell Mom what happened right away.
You don't need to finish your dinner. Hey, look at your phone when I'm talking to you. I wish I had a smaller TV. We got you that phone for a reason. Texting boys.
All right, everyone, listen up. Mom and I are going out of town this weekend, so please mess up the whole house while we're gone. Please throw a few parties while we're gone. Please forget about the dog entirely while we're gone. Hey, when you're finished pouring that, can you just leave it out on the counter all day? Thanks.
Hey, what are you doing?
I'm gonna bungee jump out of this tree.
That's a really good idea.
All right, let's take a look at the overview of the book of James, the first chapter that we looked at last week. The book of James, James was influenced by Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and the book of Proverbs, and it was written on how to live a mature life of faith in Christ. James is the author of this book. Jacob, we learned in Hebrew last week, and James is the half-brother of Jesus. Now we'll go ahead and jump into James chapter 2. James chapter 2, the theme verse here is, as the body without a spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. James 2:26. Actions Christ followers should never do. Must not show favoritism, and faith without deeds is useless. So let's look at it, okay? So here's some examples. Never judge a book by its cover. Treat all people with fairness, equality, and justice, no matter their social or economic standing. And do not act as the broken, unbelieving world does. This is basically the 3 points that James tries to get across to us. Let's take a look. James chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy old clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, here is a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand there, or sit on the floor by my feet, have you not discriminated then among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? So such a faith as this, faith without good works, operating chiefly among the realm of your interior, is not good for your neighbor. And many of your neighbors are overlooked because they don't display those characteristics like that rich man that attract your attentive favor. Playing favorites based on outward appearances is the way of the world. And the foreigner and the disabled, as spoke of in Mark 7, 24 through 37, these people are often the last people that we see living in our midst because we assume they can't do anything for us. Now, with the judgment that happened between the rich man and the poor man, God never practiced such selfish favoritism. We learn that in 1 Corinthians 1, 27 through 29. And he expects the same of those who fear, love, and trust in him above all things. We also want to look at what types of markers in your life point to faith in things such as worship of celebrities, fame, fortune. What fantasies do you entertain that life would be so much better if only you could live like them or gain from a relationship with those who have prestige, possessions, influence, power, or money? In whom or what do you place your confidence other than the work of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Is this your faith? Absent as it is of God-pleasing works? James asks of the Christians everywhere and at all times, not just those of a congregation dispersed among the Gentiles of the first century. Without inescapable evidence, the good works that inevitably emerge and accompany a genuine faith that grasps the gospel of Christ alone for forgiveness, life, and salvation, then what good is that kind of faith? Faith with no evidence is a false faith. A dead faith. And don't let anyone offer you the comforting lie that such a dead faith counts for for anything. In fact, we see in James 26, as the body without a spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. But a living faith has the fruits of faith. 14 through 16, James writes, "So what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, keep warm and well fed,' but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by actions, is dead." In the end, such a dead, good works absent faith will not benefit you. Such a dead faith is simply not compatible with our identity in Christ. The new life that we have of the resurrected Christ bestowed on you at your baptism, where by divine grace you became an adopted child of God, a brother of James, the brother of the Lord Jesus. A dead, inactive faith rejects the unity of Christ's living body sent into the world to reflect the Savior's love, a love to the loveless, shown that they might lovely be. Such a false and dead faith cannot stand up to the judgment of God. Because once a law is broken, it doesn't matter if it's just one little point of the law. Once one point of the law is broken, then all the points are broken. And we see that stated in verse 10. What counts is genuine, living, active faith. Faith continuing at work in the present time among the faithful through love. And this is from Galatians 5, 6. And this faith of Christ, his faithfulness to his goal, his faithfulness of the law on your behalf, and the genuine faith in him, faith in the gospel, the good news given to us, this message of where Christ, who triumphed over sin, death, and the devil, that will bring forth the fruit God desires in works pleasing to him. Christ is the one who does this for us. The pattern of God's grace, love, and mercy to those whom the world considers to be outsiders and worthless for you, this is where God uses you. Jesus is the ultimate outsider. He comes to his own, and his own people did not receive him, right? John 1, 11. He was made flesh to suffer rejection and humiliation, even to the point of death on a cross for you. He is the one who fulfilled the royal law perfectly for you. So let's conclude with this. You have a living faith. And this living faith, this saving faith, this faith in Christ will inevitably overflow with his good works. And these works will be seen in you to the glory and praise of Christ's holy name forever. We have a God who has provided for us. James was talking to the church, the believers, and now the same. And that message is this: because of your faith in Christ, because of what Christ has done for you, let that empower you to do these good works for Him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We now stand for our time of prayer. Lord God, we thank you for blessing our church so much with wonderful teenagers and adults and helpers for our vacation Bible school this week. Once again, we ask your Holy Spirit to work in the hearts of those children that they might believe in Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We ask that your kingdom would come and expand around this world, that you would bind the works of Satan and let loose again the power of the cross. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for all those battling cancer around the world and within our church families. Help them to rely upon your strength and your hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we pray for special healing upon Dave and upon Carol and upon Tony. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And Jesus, you have called us to be involved in worship and to be part of all that is taking place. During this time of silence, hear us as we pray for a friend, a neighbor, a child, someone who could use the touch of Christ as Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. So be with the church around this world. Let us lift up high the cross of Jesus Christ and point to the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Parish announcements for today. I want to thank all of you again who support the work of Mount Calvary Lutheran Church. God is doing great things as we minister to people all around this mountain, but especially Vacation Bible School. Next week, we have art camp for kids done by Vicar Darrell. If you know any kids who want to attend that, have them call the church. And then my Wednesday Bible study will not be meeting this week, but will be meeting the following weeks. This week is a holiday, and so I won't be here, but we encourage you to join our church in Bible study on Sunday mornings. We have an online Bible study, and again the following Wednesdays at 4:30. It is time now to go forth into the world to be light in the darkness. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.